व्हाट इज के वैल्यू?
1.11
1.11. What about fringing capacitance?
11.53.
11.
यस मैम, 11.53.
5.3 pF. And what about Z0?
30.708.
30.
यस मैम,
30.708 ohms. Okay. What about second one? K
K
equal
is
to 10.09.
1.09.
K is equal to
1.096.
1.096 CF.
10.812.
8.12 pF. Z0.
22.78. 7.8.
8. Others getting the same answer?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Is there any confusion in this chapter? Strip line? Anything you want to ask?
No, ma'am.
Okay.
No, ma'am.
Okay, good. So we'll move on to the next chapter of the third module. That is, we will be moving into the part of antenna basics. So, can anybody tell me what is actually an antenna? Generally, I'm not expecting an exact answer. How actually you know what is actually an antenna?
Which receives and produces signal.
Which receives and produces signal. Okay. Any other?
Network, ma'am.
Okay. Network. It is a kind of a network. Yeah. Then, other than that, what kind of energy we use or what kind of signal we transmit?
Usually low
AM
frequency.
waves.
AM wave, low frequency. Then, any other?
FM waves, ma'am.
FM, okay.
Radio waves.
Radio waves, okay. Now, in general, we know it is called as electromagnetic waves. So we can say that instead of saying radio wave, AM wave, FM wave, we can say it as an electromagnetic wave. So generally, what is a very simple definition of antenna is it is used for transmitting or receiving the electromagnetic waves. So whatever the electromagnetic wave or electromagnetic energy is there, we need to transmit it as well as receive it. So here in this particular module, you're going to study what is the definition of antenna, how actually the radiation happen in antenna, basic, and there are actually 9 basic parameters of antenna which you'll be studying in detail. 9 basic, how the structure of the antenna, how it is going to radiate. So all those comes into 9 parameters. So those 9 parameters is nothing but about this module. Each parameter you'll be studying. Now, coming to the definition of an antenna, as I've told you, antenna actually serves as one of the critical component in your wireless system. Now, when we say the field of antenna or the antenna which is used for transmitting the information, now it is very much easy as well as very much quick so that you can transmit the information to the world through the remote. So a purpose you can relate it to the human is, suppose if eyes and eyeglasses serve the human, the same purpose your antenna serves to the communication system. So it is one of the basic or the important concept of your antenna where it is used for transmitting and radiating your electromagnetic waves. Now, what is electromagnetic wave? Can anybody tell me what is electromagnetic wave? General electromagnetic. Okay. Now, when we talk about electromagnetic waves, it is a physical entity, or you can say electromagnetic energy. This electromagnetic energy, it is actually in your space. So electromagnetic energy, it has to radiate into the space around it. So those which are in the space with having an electromagnetic energy is nothing but an electromagnetic wave. Suppose if it radiates energy in all the directions. Then you call such a antenna as isotropic antenna. If the electromagnetic energy radiates in all the directions, suppose say it is a point source antenna here and it is radiating energy in all the directions. So if the energy is radiated in all the directions, then you say such an antenna as isotropic antenna, or it is called as omnidirectional antenna. Omnidirectional, or it is called as non-directional. So if it radiates, that is your electromagnetic wave, if it radiates energy in all the directions, then you call it as isotropic or omnidirectional or non-directional. So suppose it is not radiating in all the directions, then it is called as non-isotropic antenna, or it is a directional antenna. Now this antenna is a device. It can also be said in terms of power. So antenna is a device which is used to feed the maximum power in the required direction, or to receive maximum power in the or from the required direction. Suppose you have, I say this is a transmitter and this is a receiver. Now from the transmitter, if you are sending a maximum power, similarly your receiver will be receiving the maximum power. So an antenna is a device used to feed maximum power in the required direction, and similarly, or it is to receive maximum power from the required direction. So that is one definition in terms of power. Now we can also define in terms of a conductor. Suppose an antenna can also be defined as a system of elevated conductors. You have certain conductors which is used to couple or match the transmitter or the receiver to the free space. So a transmitting antenna will be connected to the transmitter. This antenna will be connected to the transmitter. This will be your receiving antenna, which will be again connected to the receiver. So transmitting antenna is connected to the transmitter through transmission line, and this will radiate the electromagnetic waves into the free space. Now this is nothing but your free space. So it will radiate the electromagnetic energy into the free space. Similarly, your receiving antenna, this receiving antenna will receive, or you can say intercept. When I say intercept, that receiver will do the function of intercept. Now what is an intercept is? It is nothing but divert, or it is also called as deflect. So the receiving antenna intercepts a portion of this electromagnetic waves, which is delivered to the receiver through a process of modulation. There is again a method of modulation and demodulation happening in transmitter and receiver, which we'll further look into at that. So in terms of conductors, you have elevated conductors, which is mainly used to couple or match the transmitter or receiver to the free space. So transmitting antenna is connected to the transmitter through a transmission line, and it radiates electromagnetic energy into free space. Similarly, a receiving antenna will intercept a portion of the electromagnetic waves, which is again delivered to the receiver for demodulation. There is one more definition with respect to the IEEE standard. So IEEE has taken one more definition, which is nothing but the antenna is simply a means of radiating or receiving electromagnetic waves. In a single line, it can radiate or receive electromagnetic waves. So this is the first definition which you can see here, and an antenna is usually a metallic device or a rod or wire, which is mainly used for radiating or receiving radio waves or electromagnetic waves. One more definition which is given is an antenna radio may be defined as a structure associated with a region of transition between guided wave and a free space, or it can be vice versa, that is free space and a guided wave. This is nothing but the second one which we saw, from transmitter to receiver. One more definition is antenna is transitional structure between free space and a guiding device. All three give you the same definition. Altogether, it gives you a sense that it is radiating or receiving an electromagnetic waves. So this is regarding the definition of your antenna. Now, one more thing is you have to see how actually the antenna is radiating. Before that, there is a basic equation of antenna, that is which is in terms of, or basic equation of radiation, which is expressed as IL is equal to QV. This is nothing but ampere meter per second, where L will give you the length of current element, which is in terms of meter, and Q is nothing but the charge, which is in coulomb. V is nothing but velocity, that is meter per second square. So V is nothing but time change velocity, which is again equal to the acceleration of charge, meter per second square. This I is nothing but the time changing current, which is with respect to time. So it is ampere per second. Now this equation is called as the equation, or the basic equation of radiation. One equation you have to remember, that is for the radiation, it is given as IL is equal to QV. Now we'll talk about what is principle of radiation, that is how actually the radiation takes place in antenna. Now, when the process of radiation, radiating electromagnetic waves into free space, whenever I say radiation, it is nothing but radiating electromagnetic wave into free space. That is nothing but the process is called as radiation. That means you have electromagnetic waves here. These electromagnetic waves are in free space. The process of radiating from your transmitter section, the electromagnetic waves into free space, is nothing but radiation. Now, the principle of radiation is actually illustrated with this figure. Now, this figure, I will just explain you the transmitter part first. The same figure, just this part I'm explaining you first. Here you have, you can see there is a generator, there is a transmission line and an antenna. And these are nothing but the waves which are launched into free space. Blue lines are nothing but the electric field lines of radiated wave. The arrow mark which the wave is going inside, this is called as guided electromagnetic wave. And the region where you can see it is elevated to outside, it is called as transition region. Now here, the transmitter section, it is used to generate usually the high frequency carrier wave. We need actually the high frequency wave. So the transmitter is mainly used to generate the high frequency carrier wave, and hence it will produce modulation. Now, you know, modulation is nothing but what is modulation?
Strengthening the signal.
Yeah. What is that? What frequency you have, based on what you define a modulation?
Carrier frequency.
Yeah. It is nothing but instantaneous value of your carrier signal is changing with respect to your modulating signal. So you have the process of modulation taking place here. So this transmission line is called as a two-wire transmission line. You can see a wire here and you can see a wire here. So it is a two-wire transmission line which is connected to the radio frequency generator. That is this. This is a generator. To this, a two-wire transmission line is connected to the radio frequency generator or a transmitter. And this is used to guide the wave or guide a plane, which is nothing but your transverse electromagnetic wave. What is transverse electromagnetic wave? What is TEM wave? What did you see in the strip line? So it is a mode of propagation where you can say transverse electromagnetic. You have electric and magnetic field lines, which are all restricted to one direction. So it is a direction of propagation. So plane waves are transverse electromagnetic waves. So here you guide these transverse electromagnetic waves in the transmission line, so that now in the uniform section here, the waves will travel due in the tapered end of the transition region, and in this uniform section, the dimension of this transmission line, what we have taken here, it is only a fraction of order of wavelength which is used, a very small with respect to the wavelength. So transmission line will then open out into a tapered transition. So this is called as tapered transition. And when the dimension is of order of wavelength, which is taken, it will act like an antenna now. Now, when the dimension change here, now it is having a tapered transition here. So it will act like an antenna and launches into the free space. So the waves which are traveling, you can see it is the direction of the waves which changes. And once it is, it reaches the transition region, it will be into the free space. Now, this is actually the transmitter section. The same opposite happens in your receiver section. At the receiving end here, the receiving antenna will receive the free space wave, which is then again guided into your, from the transition region to a two transmission line. So, which is guided to a two-wire transmission line. And at the receiver here, demodulation should take place. And then you are getting it through a receiver. So the whole process takes only few steps. That is, you will have a generator or a transmitter. There is a two-wire transmission line. You have transverse electromagnetic waves in between your two-wire transmission line, which is generated from the transmitter, which is nothing but a guided TEM wave, which is again one-dimensional wave. This wave is sent into, or it will be going into a transition region. So in the transition region, or what you say as antenna, the waves are sent into the free space, where the free space is of three dimension. You will have electromagnetic waves. These waves are again traveling through the receiver. It will be received through the receiver, that is through a transition region again. It is guided into a two-wire transmission line for the receiver. In terms of transmitter, the modulation takes place. Inside the receiver, the demodulation takes place. This is how actual process takes place in your antenna. That is how it can radiate your electromagnetic waves to the free space. It's fine?
Yes, ma'am.
Now we'll move on to the basic antenna parameters. Now the complete module is on these parameters. You will be studying in detail the different parameters of the antenna. Now there are actually 9 parameters in the antenna. The first one, we talk about the beam pattern, or it will call it as radiation pattern. The second one is called as beam area, or it is called as beam solid angle. The third one, it is beam efficiency. And fourth, it is radiation intensity, radiation resistance, directivity and gain, antenna aperture, effective height or area, and the last one is bandwidth. So these are the 9 parameters which you have to remember. And again, each parameter has different properties with respect to the antenna. So moving on to the first one, that is a radiation pattern. So when I say radiation pattern, so the definition of radiation pattern, or the radiation, how it actually has a figure is, now energy radiated by an antenna, told you, you are going to radiate, or the electromagnetic waves will radiate in all the directions. Now here the energy radiated by an antenna is not in all, or is not the same in all directions. Either it will be in one direction, or it will be zero, or it will be less in other directions. So the energy radiated, we are talking about non-isotropic antenna. Energy radiated by an antenna is not in all the directions, or not in same in all the directions. In one direction, it can have only one, only with respect to one direction, or it can be zero, or it can be less in other direction. So the energy radiated in particular direction, it will be measured in terms of electric field strength at a given point and at a particular distance. Again, the three-dimensional representation, or a three-dimensional graphical representation of electric field strength of an electromagnetic field at all points This is called as radiation pattern. You have to draw this figure or draw the pattern of your antenna electric field strength. So if you are graphically representing your electric field strength, that is nothing but your radiation pattern. So in order to plot this radiation pattern, you need to determine this electric field strength first. That too at all the points, wherever the radiation is happening, there you have to first find out what is electric field strength. So in order to plot the radiation pattern, we need to determine the electric field strength at all the points. And since it is three-dimensional representation, you can consider the imaginary figure of the sphere. So on the imaginary of the sphere or the points on the sphere, you can get what is actually electric field strength. And if the radiation in a particular direction is expressed in terms of electric field strength, then you say it as field strength pattern. I'll explain you once again, field strength pattern. Similarly, if the radiation is in any direction, this is with respect to particular direction. If it is in any direction, then you represent that in terms of power, and the resulting pattern is called as power pattern. Tell you once again, radiation pattern is nothing but energy radiated by an antenna will not be usually same in all the directions. It can be with respect to one particular direction, or that radiation can be zero, or it can be less in other directions. So energy directed or energy radiated in a particular direction can be measured in terms of electric field strength at a given point for a particular distance. So a three-dimensional representation, graphical representation of this electric field strength of an electromagnetic field at all the points is nothing but your radiation pattern. So you need to plot this radiation pattern. So for that, we need to determine the electric field strength at all the points on the surface of an imaginary sphere. Now, this graphical representation of radiation from an antenna, it is a function of direction, which is nothing but radiation pattern. If the radiation pattern or if the radiation is in particular direction in terms of your electric field strength, that is called as field strength pattern. If it is in any direction in terms of power, then you call it as, that pattern is called as power pattern. Always power pattern is proportional to square of electric field strength pattern. This is very important in terms of problem. Power is always directly proportional to square of field strength pattern. Two times, that is E square, P is directly proportional to E square. Or if I show you in terms of, so field radiation pattern is, if the radiation of an antenna represent graphically as a function of particular direction, it is called as field radiation pattern. And it is 3D pattern or three-dimensional pattern, represents the radiation for all angles theta and phi. The field pattern is expressed mathematically in terms of relative field pattern. This we'll see later, normalized field pattern. Now here, spherical, why we are taking theta and phi? Because you know spherical coordinate system. Since we are taking three-dimensional, which are the coordinates of a spherical coordinate system? Coordinates of spherical coordinate system.
R, pi and z.
Okay. It is R, comma theta, comma phi, which is spherical coordinate system. If you consider a point in a spherical coordinate system, usually we represent spherical coordinate system in three-dimensional, something like this. You might have studied in electromagnetic theory. This is your Z, and this is Y, and this is X. Suppose if I consider a point P in a spherical coordinate system, where you need to represent that is R. R is called as radial displacement, and you have theta as well as you have phi. Theta and phi are called as angular displacement. R is called as radial displacement theta and phi are called as angular displacements. Now for this rotation about R gives you a spherical surface. We know if we rotate this particular point, then you get a sphere or a spherical surface. So rotation of point P about angle theta gives you cone. That is, at a point, say it is reaching for here, that is P dash. So at a point, if you're just rotating in terms of theta, that will give you cone. And if you rotate for an about angle of phi, that will give you plane. So this is just basic, because when you do the derivation of beam area, you should be knowing all these things. So which is important in terms of spherical coordinate system. Now here in the field pattern, in order to completely specify your radiation pattern, you need three components in the radiation pattern. The first component is called as your theta component. So theta component of an electric field as a function of angles theta and phi, you represent it as E theta comma phi. Again, the unit is volt per meter. This three components for a radiation component pattern, if you need to completely specify it, you need three components. First component is called as theta component. Then the second component The next component is called as phi component of an electric field strength. This is again in terms of theta and phi. So E phi, which is theta comma phi, in terms of volt per meter. The third component is called as phase of these two components, theta component and phi component. So phase of theta and phi as a function of theta and phi, which is represented as delta theta, comma phi, and delta phi, comma theta, comma phi. Again, the unit of this is radian or degree. So these three components are required so that you can specify the radiation pattern. Next, the next term which you need to remember here is called as relative or normalized field strength pattern. I want you to write down the formulas: relative or normalized field strength pattern. Now, in order to find the normalized field strength pattern, how do you actually do the normalization, or what is normalization? In terms of microwave, we did by dividing that particular by Z naught as a normalization. But here, always a normalization is nothing but divide that component by its maximum value. So here, since we are talking about electric field strength and power pattern, you have to divide the field component by its maximum value. That is nothing but normalization. So in order to find the normalized field strength pattern or field strength, we need to divide the field component by its maximum value. Again, since we are dividing the same field component by its maximum value, it is dimensionless. You don't have a dimension. And the maximum value, the number with maximum value, what you can get here is unity. So now if we talk about electric field strength pattern, which is represented in terms of E theta or E phi. First, we'll talk about this component, E theta, theta comma phi. This is normalization. So I'll represent it with a subscript N. Now, what is its field component, or how do you represent in terms of normalization? Which is the field component? This is your field component. That is E theta, comma phi, divided by its maximum value is nothing but E theta, comma phi max. Understood? How do you write the equation? Field component divided by its maximum value. Same component, just divided by its maximum value. You will get what is normalized value. Similarly, if I write for the second, that is E phi, comma theta comma phi normalization, which is equal to here E phi of theta comma phi divided by E phi of theta comma phi max. So these two are nothing but the normalized or relative field strength pattern. Is that clear?
Yes, ma'am.
The next one, that is second one, we need to again write about normalized. We had two patterns there. One is electric field pattern, strength pattern. One more is power pattern. Now it is normalized field power pattern or it is relative power pattern. So when we say power pattern, again, power is expressed in terms of power per unit area, power pattern, or power per unit area is also called as pointing vector, where pointing vector is expressed as S of theta comma phi. So we need to write normalized power pattern equation. We know normalized power pattern is nothing but P of theta comma phi normalization. You can write it in terms of theta comma phi divided by P of theta comma phi max. Or if you're writing in terms of pointing vector, it is S of theta comma phi divided by S of theta comma phi max. Again, it is dimensionless. So what is actually pointing theorem in terms of electric field strength is S of theta comma phi. If you're representing, I've told you power is directly proportional to E square. So you have two electric fields here, E theta square of theta comma phi plus E phi square of theta comma phi divided by Z naught. This is E square equation, E square by Z naught. If you remember power equation in terms of E, E square by Z naught, since you have two components varying theta and phi, I've written T, two components adding together of electric field divided by Z naught. Why it is E square? Because power is always directly proportional to E square. So it is, you can write it in terms of pointing vector. This is pointing vector in terms of electric field strength. This is the normalized power pattern. So the unit of this is watt per meter square. And this S of theta comma phi is nothing but the pointing vector or maximum value of pointing vector. Z naught is nothing but the characteristic impedance, what we take usually 376.7 ohm. Value of characteristic impedance of the Z naught. So this is about power pattern. Clear the screen. Now, how do you get Z naught as 376 is ratio of electric field to flux density in terms of electric and magnetic field. The Z naught equation is something like this. You might have studied in electromagnetic theory. Z naught is the ratio of electric field to the magnetic flux density, or Z naught can also be represented as mu naught into C naught, that is your velocity of light, 4 pi into 10 to the power minus 7 into 3 into 10 power 8. So just remember it, not required at just for this module, it is not required. So this is the general thing of the field strength pattern as well as the power pattern. The same equations you can see in the normalized field strength as well. So this is E of theta comma n, which is E theta of theta comma phi, E theta of theta comma phi max. Similarly, E phi normalization or normalized field pattern, it is E phi of theta comma phi divided by E phi of theta comma phi max. Similarly, when you consider power pattern, so when the radiation is given in a given direction is expressed in terms of power per unit solid angle, it is called as power radiation pattern. Power density is called as power flow per unit area, and is function of direction, that is theta comma phi. If you are representing power, this equation, power density, P of theta comma phi by P of theta comma phi max. The next topic is called as radiation pattern law. Now, these all comes under your first parameter, that is radiation pattern. Now, you studied the radiation pattern 3, that is electric field strength and power pattern, which comes in the graphical representation of radiation pattern. The next thing is, when you draw a radiation pattern, you will have lobes. Now, different parts of the radiation pattern, this is actually a radiation pattern. The different parts of this radiation pattern is called as radiation pattern lobes. Now, this is actually classified into major lobe and minor lobe. Before that, I'll show you actually how it is. Then you will understand the figure. So this radiation pattern, it is actually divided into two main lobes. One is called as a major lobe. One is called as minor lobe. Now here, this minor lobe is again classified into back lobe and it is called as side lobe. So radiation lobe, if you have to define it, it is defined as portion of a radiation pattern which is bounded by the radiations of or regions of weak radiation intensity, or it is nothing but it is a pattern of or the different parts of your radiation pattern, which is actually divided into major lobe and minor lobe. Now we'll talk about the major lobe first. When I say major lobe, it is called as the main lobe of your radiation pattern. It is defined as the radiation lobe, which contains direction of maximum radiation. So here, this lobe will give you maximum radiation direction. Any lobe except your major lobe, then others are called as minor lobe. Any lobe except your major lobe is called as minor lobe. Now I told you it is divided into two different types, back lobe and side lobe. Now the side lobe, it will be usually major lobe is represented as like this in your radiation pattern. This is something which is having maximum radiation. Other than that, the smaller ones are called as your minor lobes. Now, this is a major lobe. Now, we'll talk about side lobe. It is normally adjacent to the main lobe. Now, this is your main lobe. It should be adjacent to your side, that is main lobe. So, this is called as side lobe. Now, this occupies the hemisphere in the direction of main lobe. Now, this is something like a hemisphere. So this will occupy the hemisphere in the direction of the main lobe. Next is back lobe. Now it is a minor lobe which occupies the opposite of the hemisphere. Now this is the hemisphere opposite. This means it will be somewhere here, opposite to that major lobe. So this is called as your back lobe. So the first one, that is major lobe, it is called as the main lobe of your radiation pattern. It is defined as the radiation pattern or radiation lobe, which contains direction of maximum radiation. Any lobe except your major lobe is called as minor lobe. Here you have back lobe and side lobe. The very adjacent to the major lobe is called as your side lobe. The opposite to your major lobe is nothing but your back lobe. Now, usually what minor lobe represent is this minor lobes. This will represent the unwanted radiation. And since unwanted radiation usually affect our system, we have to minimize this unwanted radiation. Side lobes are largest in terms of your minor lobe, because again, you have a back lobe and side lobe. Compared to the back lobe, side lobes are greater. That is, in terms of size, side lobes are the largest of the minor lobes. And you have a formula to define your minor lobe, which is called as level of minor lobe. Level of minor lobe is given as ratio of power density of your side lobe to the power density of your major lobe. If you have to define the level of a minor lobe, it is given as ratio of power density of your side lobe divided by power density of your major lobe. This parameter is also called as side lobe level, or it is called as side lobe ratio. So side lobe level of around minus 20 dB is usually tolerable in your communication system. And usually for construction and all, if you are going for minus 30 dB, then you have to design it very carefully so that in the construction part, it should not be giving you any problem. So if you can just look into the figure of what we have seen earlier, radiation pattern lobe. So see the figure, I have drawn it in a vertical section. Here it is in horizontal section. So this major lobe, that is your main lobe, this is across the maximum direction or maximum radiation. The one which is near to your major lobe is nothing but your side lobes. Now side lobes can be more than one, two or three. The last that is opposite here, that is your back lobes. So all these small lobes are called as your minor lobes. So this is about radiation pattern lobe. Two lobes you will have, major lobe and minor lobe. Then you are going to define the level of a minor lobe, which is ratio of power density of side lobe to the power density of major lobe. And this is also called a side lobe level or side lobe ratio. Is that okay?